Yoga and joining the tattvas, the gunas, continuing now with the jñānendriyāḥ. So the jñānendriyāḥ, these are the sense powers of knowing. The five senses of hearing, touching, seeing, tasting and smelling that we're already quite familiar with. Now, these five senses are known as tattvas, because they are aspects of existence. So what does tattva mean? Tat means that. Tva means having the quality of. So it's like tattva means thatness. That means that which exists. So all these tattvas are aspects of reality, aspects of that which exists. Another thing they are also called, another way they're referred to, is as gunas. Say guna. Now, a guna means a member of a group. Guna can also refer to the collective group, the whole group, or parts of the group. So all of these tattvas are gunas. They are parts of ourself. They make up, if you like, the gang of our being. So we've already mentioned the panchamahabhutaha, the five great elements, the tanmatraha, the realms of sense experience associated with each of those elements. And we've just spoken briefly about the karmendriyaha, these amazing powers of action. So now we'll speak about these sense powers. These we're already familiar with. Shrotra, hearing. Tvak, touching, touch and feeling. Shrotra is said to dwell in the ear, touch, feeling to dwell through the whole body. Chakshu, dwelling in the eye. Jiffa, dwelling on the tongue. Jiffa being tasting. And grana, dwelling in the nose, being fragrance. Now, these five, we're familiar with them, but how much attention do we pay to them? Do we really work with them respectfully? One of the basic recipes for yoga practice is to engage respectfully with what is. Now, these things are in us. We do have a sense power of smelling, tasting, seeing, touching, and hearing. Do we respect them? Do we harness them as well as we could? Do we use them to their true potential or capacity? And do we use them in the way that our deeper consciousness, our deeper essence, or our soul would like? Interesting things to contemplate, I would say. Now, you might have noticed that the way that we engage the senses can have a big impact on whether or not we feel balanced or well. So yoga is about balance. So for example, I notice that for many, many years I lived without any television. And this was in the days before I didn't have a laptop in those years. I was teaching in a university in Thailand for some of that time. I would go to the cinema occasionally. And I noticed because I didn't interface much with screens, that when I saw something on the screen, it would enter my awareness or my consciousness quite powerfully. So it alerted me to how powerful things that we perceive through the eyes can be. So the idea in yoga is everything that we experience leaves an impression. So I want to make sure, if I want to live in a balanced way, that whatever I'm exposed to, I can still maintain balance. Now, if I notice that when I expose myself to a certain type of TV program or movie or whatever it might be, it has a very unsettling or disturbing effect on my balance, I might think, well, I would want to be a bit more careful how I interact with that type of media, for example. When we think of, for example, Maybe you've had this experience that sometimes you, I would really like to listen to that type of music right now. Or, I just love to feel this warm sun on my bare skin. Or I'd love to feel the water, like swimming in the sea. Or I'd love to be in the arms of my beloved, whatever it might be. Sometimes we have a particularly strong craving for a particular sense experience. So yoga is all about paying attention. So what can I notice about which senses seem to be calling for more attention, more respect? Now let's think of these sense powers. They're powerful entities, powerful forces that reside within this greater body of our kingdom. Now, if you're the king or the queen, you're the sovereign of this realm, and you have these powerful indriya, these senses, these sense powers dwelling in your kingdom, in your realm, a good sovereign is going to make sure that all these different powerful forces that reside within the kingdom can coexist peacefully. And so a good sovereign will treat them all with respect, will ensure that they feel valued and they feel seen and recognized. And this is one of the almost, I was going to say, magical things about yoga practice. Like right now, for example, I'm in quarantine. I'm in an isolated place. So, for example, some people are used to having a lot of physical touch. They're used to hugging close friends and family members a lot. What do you do if you're in a state of isolation? You have no human touch. And if you have no pets, you have no animal touch. What are you going to do? The idea is that in yoga practice, you can exercise the sense power of touch by the way you move in space, by the way you pay attention to that. So you can, for example, feel, notice, meditate upon the sensations in your body. You can kind of exercise and nourish, give respect and nutrition to the sense power of touch without having to touch any particular person, place or thing, for example. Similarly, I really want to listen to that particular song, that particular style of music. It's not available. I can hear the birds singing. I can give thanks for the sense power of hearing. I can tune into the sounds near and far. And perhaps when I do exercises like that, the craving for that particular external sound may be vastly reduced. So as that yoga teaches us to become more and more independent. Even these sense powers, of course, they help us relish the external world. They help us navigate it. For example, if you've been away for a while and you open your fridge and then smells terrible, the sense power of smell alerts us. Do not eat that. Get rid of it. Get it out on the compost heap. You know, dispose of that thing. It's not good for you. More subtly, maybe the food looks good. Oh, no. Like the other day, I was in a tropical place recently. I had a mango. It was too ripe. Oh, no. It looked fine. But oh, no, it's too ripe. It's not going to be no good for me. Got to give it to the animals. For example, so the sense powers, they are powerful. They can pull us out of balance. So say, for example, you have a certain sense craving and we overindulge it. What does it generally lead to? Some type of suffering, some type of imbalance. So the idea is when we keep all our senses kind of in smooth working order, we keep them in check, we keep them exercised, we keep them on their toes, we engage with them respectfully, then they can support us to have richer experiences in whatever we do. So whatever I'm tasting, can I taste it with all of my presence? Now, thinking of taste as well, like, are you living tastefully? Are you living according to your own tastes? Or are you allowing your taste to be dictated by these external forces of the mainstream or the external realm. I like what Clarissa Pinkola Estes says about, she says, do not make the mistake of choosing what you want to do in life from the menu that external reality offers you. Instead, look inside. In the words of Bob Marley, open your eyes and look within. Are you satisfied with the life you're living? What would it mean to live tastefully according to you? So again, we can see every tattva, every gana, can be a powerful lens of inquiry to help us look into, am I inviting yoga as I would really like to in my life? Am I inviting myself into at-one-ment and attunement and balance and harmony as I really could? So I think that's a reasonable look at the jñānendriyāḥ. But before we leave the indriya collectively, just want to say a little bit about the root of this word, which we'll consider further when we look at the next three. But indriyaha is related to the Sanskrit word indra. And Indra, in the Indian mythology, is the king of the gods, or the king of heaven, or the king of the divine powers. And the indriyaha are the powers of Indra. So what does this say? You have the powers of Indra. You have the powers of the king or queen of heaven. Whoa! Wait a minute. I, human being, have the powers of the king of heaven. Wait a minute, what does that mean? Heaven, in the Indian system, is a place in which desires are instantly realized, in which all desires are met. So what does this mean? One idea is that if, when, we can learn to use these indriyaha skillfully, yogically, in a balanced, integrated way, we can come to a state of desirelessness, the state that is known as nirvāṇa. The idea is that is our innate capacity. We have all the equipment, all the tools, all the capacities we need. It's just about how we work with them, how we deploy our gifts. And yoga is intended to help us assume full and skillful sovereignty for our experience so we can, in the reality of this bodily incarnation, experience that state of wholeness, the consequence of which is nirvana, that desireless whole state.